Leghorn, Italy, one phase of a huge materiel redeployment program involves the salvage and reconditioning of American supplies and weapons left over after the defeat of Germany. An Army estimate indicates that at least 70% of its equipment in the European and Mediterranean theaters is earmarked for use in the war against Japan. Battle-worn vehicles arriving at this collection point are stripped of motors and other usable parts. Steam cleaning motor blocks and crankshafts before reconditioning. Jeep engines are overhauled and prepared for shipment at the rate of 115 per day. Italian civilians and German PWs are employed at this center under the supervision of Army technicians and mechanics. The job of rehabilitating equipment has been underway for some time. In addition to the depots in Italy, 81 repair bases are now going full blast in France, Belgium, and England. Checking and repair is not the whole job of preparing ordnance, signal corps, and other material for the Pacific Front. Differences in battle and climatic conditions require modifications and special processing. Precautions must be taken against corrosion and fungi. Delicate precision instruments must be given waterproofing treatment and packaging before moving into the humidity and tropical storms of the Far East. Preparing surgical instruments for reissue. After a thorough cleaning, they're placed in a drying oven with a temperature of 250 degrees. Then the instruments are dipped in an oil solution and allowed to drain off before packing. All medical equipment that can be spared is being rushed to the Pacific. The instruments are wrapped in moisture-proof paper, which in turn is carefully sealed with a layer of wax. In the small arms shipping section, rifles which have been completely overhauled are given final check and dipped in a cosmoline vat. Repair and distribution of materiel is coordinated with troop movements. Units going directly to the Pacific hold on to their equipment and get replacements for anything deficient. Outfits redeployed to the United States leave their weapons at various depots. Renovated equipment normally goes from the depots into a central stock pool, from which orders are filled for direct shipment to the Pacific. General Ox and other officers inspect disassembly and crating operations at the Ordnance Vehicle Park. Central clearing point for all shipments to the Pacific out of this area is the 10th Port Quartermaster in Transit Depot. Loading of Liberty ships goes on 24 hours a day. While materiel movements reach an accelerated pace, troop departures continue out of redeployment centers of the Assembly Area Command. Men of the 156th Field Artillery Battalion, 44th Division, are processed at Camp Pittsburgh, Mourmelon sub-area near Reims, France. The troops pack their own cosmoline Colt 45 automatics. About 2.5 million men are expected to pass through E.T.O. processing centers. Floodwaters inundate the fertile Waringermeer area in Holland when the Germans blow up the dike erected to hold back the waters of the Zuider Zee. The country is a patchwork of 2,500 polders, reclaimed land areas which can easily be flooded. Three villages and 400 farms are destroyed in the Waringermeer polder, 5 meters below sea level. The people salvage what they can from the wreckage of their homes. Although repair work on the bombed-out dikes is underway, Holland's rich agricultural lands are expected to be unproductive for years as a result of the saltwater flooding. German war prisoners remove landmines from the Netherlands. In the province of North Holland, 1.5 million mines planted by the Nazis are being dug up at the rate of 3,000 a day. Removing a German VB wooden box mine designed for use against tanks and other vehicles. The mine weighs 18 pounds, is about 12 inches square, and requires a pressure of approximately 200 pounds for detonation. The mines are carried to a secluded area and then destroyed. In Norway, German prisoners of war are likewise employed to dig up mines which the Nazis planted during their long occupation of the country. Prisoners are compelled to prod and measure known minefields where mines are laid in rows four deep. A fuse and charge are used for detonations. These anti-personnel shoe mines are exploded four at a time. A Norwegian army guard checks off the mines as they're blown up. The prisoners prod the cleared areas with sticks to make sure there are no mines left which might later kill Norwegians. At Esterwegen prison camp, Germany, high-ranking German officers who are known war criminals are demobilized from the German army and made civilian prisoners of war. No longer entitled to privileges awarded prisoner of war officers, they are now to be treated as ordinary criminals. The men march back to the parade ground after exchanging their Army, Navy, and Air Force uniforms for denim work clothes. Approximately 800 prisoners are transformed from officers into civilians in a 20-minute ceremony. As civilian prisoners, they'll be compelled to perform necessary prison camp labors. Transportation of litter cases over terrain which is inaccessible to vehicles may require up to four men. Often it's difficult for medical corpsmen to penetrate jungle growth or climb hills and ravines. Because of this, the Army has adopted a one-man carry, which requires no equipment other than that normally worn by two soldiers. Cartridge belts are used to make a sling. One belt is put under the thighs. The victim's simulated broken leg has already been placed in a rifle splint. The other belt is slipped under the small of the back. This field expedient for rapid removal of a casualty by only one man is learned easily. The participants in the demonstration now in progress are actually doing it for the first time. After both belts are in position, they are joined together. Cartridge belts are recommended for the job, although rifle slings, other belts, or bandages may be used. Next, the buckles are slipped under the wounded man so that two smooth loops are formed. These loops will fit over the shoulders of the man who's doing the carrying. Now it's necessary to get the loops over the shoulders. This is done rapidly by following a simple procedure. Lying down in the manner shown, he's able to slip his arms through the loops and secure an unbreakable hold on the casualty. Here's the way it's accomplished. When he's sure his position is firm, the soldier rolls over, pulling the wounded man on top of him. Naturally, he rolls over on the uninjured side of the casualty. The final step is to get up from the ground and begin the trek to an aid station. The one-man carry is a Russian method which women medical personnel were able to master and perform without undue difficulty. This carry has proved itself easier on a wounded man than any other improvisation when a litter is not available. It can be used for almost every injury except an abdominal wound. Also, the carrier has the advantage of free use of his hands to aid in climbing. He can even use his rifle if necessary. Because it requires no extra equipment or detailed training, it's expected that the one-man carry will see widespread use in the Pacific combat areas.